Were they scared?
Live from the ESPN 1280 studios in San Luis Obispo, it's time. It is Living the Run. We're not just chewing the fat, we're getting rid of it. We are your home for everything health and fitness. Living the Run is being brought to you by Puma Aquatics, Standard Process Nutrition, Peak Performance Massage, and the chiropractic team at Slow Wellness Center. Here are your hosts for Living the Run, Rex Stevens and Paul Tarek.
Wednesday edition. Ah, welcome to a Wednesday edition. That's a little bit better, Max. Heated argument to start this thing off. Welcome to Wednesday edition. But actually, you know, Wednesday edition, it's the only edition. We're still only once a week. Producer Max Woodcock has not gotten us on 5 days. I'm your host, Rex Stevens, in studio with Paul Tarek. But I think the once a week is a good thing right now.
Right now,
Paul,
yeah.
You're having trouble making it once a month.
I know. It's rough, dude. But when I show back up, this is what I have to deal with. You guys missed it. The audience, you totally missed almost fisticuffs between Max and Rex. It was over Prop 37. Of all things,
we don't really want to get into politics on.
We totally do.
Because here's the deal. Here's why we don't want to get into politics. Because your health is in your hands, your decision making, and that's the whole point of Living the Run is leaving it out there, getting inspiring guests to let people know they can make the change. They don't have to be reliant on their government to have good health. They don't have to be reliant on anyone else other than the decisions they make to make those good health decisions, those things to maximize their human potential. We got a couple guests today, Paul, who are doing just that. We've had them both on before. We're going to get updates from them. You weren't here, Paul, I don't think, for either guest. Again, another
chances
reason.
chances are pretty likely, yeah.
Yeah, the summer was a little rough for you. But Winter Vanecki, gosh, if you guys missed this interview way back, that's when Max and I were agreeing, actually, on a few things. And
Did you guys just break up a second ago? I mean, it was got a little rough there.
Tears coming down the face with Winter Vanecki. I'm telling you, this is one of the most stunning 13-year-olds you've ever heard. She was out there for the New York City Marathon. Obviously, that got canceled, as we all know, Hurricane Sandy. And she's going to have some good story out there. Again, Paul, she's going to be the first or the youngest girl to run 7 marathons on 7 continents. And since we last talked to Winter, she was in Kenya. Really, really amazing story.
So just to summarize what you said, a 13-year-old girl made you cry. Is that what everybody else got? Or Max, is that what you got too?
Max got that too. And, it's better than what was going on there with Max and I. I wasn't near tears there.
You guys were getting angry.
get a little excited about the politics. But again, this show is not about politics. It's about health and wellness, Paul. And what have you been doing lately for your health and fitness? I know you've been overworking. It's classic for Americans, right? Classic. And this is the thing that we see over and over and over again is a lot of Americans' health is affected simply because they're working too much. Or in your case, and this is, research through and through, this is a great one, working the late hours, then coming back and trying to figure out how to sleep and not being able to sleep.
Yeah, that's been a tough one for me. I thought with all the years of traveling back and forth to different countries and getting on different sleep schedules, it would be a lot easier for me. But the more you work in a row, by the time you get to the end of those late shifts, it wears on you. It takes you a good 3-4 days to get back into the swing of things. But the good news is I'm back at least awake for the 5 to 6 hour here. What time is it? 6 to 7 here. I don't know what time it is anymore. That time change and everything, it was all sorts of weird.
Maybe that's part of the problem. Maybe that's why we haven't been getting you in here to the studio.
I've been here every day. My clock's just been off. Yeah.
I thought the biggest problem for your health was going to be, Paul, I heard that you were by yourself for the weekend with your son, right? Wife left. This is like single dad. Yeah. I thought for sure you were going to be worn down.
Yeah, I cannot keep up with a 2-year-old. I can't do it. I thought I could. Everybody's like, oh, kids are so easy. I'm like, yeah, I can totally run faster than all of them, and I'm stronger than him. Yeah, no way. I can totally keep up. I don't know how parents do it. I don't know how parents with more than one kid do it.
Yeah.
I see like a mom out in the store with like 3 kids, and I just want to go give her a hug and be like, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, it's a crazy deal. You know, my kids, we had a ton of fun last Wednesday, Halloween, and that's why we weren't here. Ran a good show, good replay of a show last week. But, you know, Halloween was great. My sons both were Iron Men. And one of the questions they always ask, first thing they ask when they put the Iron Man costume on is, Dad, are my muscles bigger than yours? Dad, am I faster than you? And then the next question is, they ask about a Living the Run guest. Dad, am I faster than Van? Referring to Van McCarty, one of our favorite guests. It's good stuff.
Yeah, we'll have to fill everybody in on it. We visited Rex the other day at home, and it was really funny. His kids asked me how old I was, and I told them, and they said, wow, it was mind-boggling to them. My dad is older than you, but you're a little bigger. And I'm like, yeah, I might be a little taller, but you know, whatever, it's not a big... But he's older, so he's smarter than you, right? Yes, he is smarter than me. And he's stronger than you, right? Yes, your dad is stronger than me, too. I think they think that, like, with each year of age, it's kind of one of these things that you get, you know? Like,
it is.
Or somebody's telling them lies.
Not me. Although it has to be me. My wife was gone for a while too, and great to have her back. But things run a little bit differently when dad's in charge. There's
with the wife or the mom, it's like there's order and you know, it's just sanity. And with the dad, it's like you're constantly like trying to put out a fire.
Well, we'll get after some of this food stuff. We've been checking in with Virginia every week. We say we like to eat with Virginia, and she's been giving us different tips. You know, if you haven't gotten some of these tips, take it back to what, Paul? What's the deal here? Max, maybe hit the pause on the video there. That might be helpful for us. But we eat with Virginia every week. She's giving us lots of tips on how to maximize your food, how to not worry about whether Prop 37 passed or not, yes or no, how to grow a lot of your own stuff, and how to use things that benefit you pre- and post-workout, how to rejuvenate that system, reduce inflammation, and so forth. One of the hot topics Virginia and I were talking about before the show, and she's coming on with us, and as we sit here, salad. Everybody loves salad, and a couple of dressings. Dressings are a big, big topic out there, in the health world. And one of the biggest culprits for using ingredients, MSGs, other products and ingredients that are causing people some harm. So, Virginia, thanks for joining us. Tell us about what we're looking at here, what we're putting on our salad, and how these things are different than what we might see in the pre-made bottles.
Well, good evening. I'm a little worried about Paul. It sounds like he needs a little more than salad this evening to get going.
If only you could see him in video, in studio.
I'm wasting away.
That man some salad dressing. One of the things that people always come to me in regards to is when they start to increase their vegetable and fruit load, is that they hate raw vegetables. They hate raw fruit. I get it. It's not that enjoyable. And one of the things we really need to focus on is that eating food is supposed to bring joy and nourishment. It's not supposed to be a negative chore. People are like, I can't eat my carrots without that Italian dressing. You flip over that bottle of dressing, how many of those ingredients do you recognize or can you pronounce? It's unbelievable. And I'm not just talking the ones from, your basic grocery store. I'm talking the ones from the health food stores. How many words on there do you even know? So one of the things I want to explain to people is that the concept of dressing your food goes back hundreds of years. This is not like things came in bottles and plastic labels put on shelves and it's like this new invention. There's some basic components to creating dressings. And one of the reasons why we create dressings is A, to get a better balance to our vegetables, to give us satisfaction by including things like citrus and fat. But honestly, it's to give it flavor, color, and texture. Those are all the things as humans that we need to desire food. It's almost an artistic expression of food. So I gave you guys two dressings, and we're going to shake it up tonight. There's a little trick that I do that people seem to love. Mason jars. They sell them at New Frontiers. They sell them at Ace Hardware. They're just glass containers that people use for canning.
New invention there, Virginia. New invention.
I know, it's crazy. So it's very expensive. I'm gonna label it, and eventually a proposition will be put against it or something. So.
But probably because I know Max is worried about litigation with those glass jars. These are the kinds of things that worry him tremendously.
And we're off. Here it goes.
So you're gonna have to talk to Max a little bit about this one. But
toxin and food safety. So we don't want any glass jars. So don't shake too big vigorously. I know that, I don't know who's stronger between the two of you. I think there was some argument about who's bigger, who's stronger.
According to Rex's sons, he is stronger than I am.
But when they wear the Iron Man costume, they are definitely stronger.
Yeah, I think the Hulk is stronger, according to Rick.
Yeah, totally. No question about it. Talk about, one of the things, of course, as you know, that trips people up is that they get concerned about how hard it is to make these, how many ingredients they have to have to be able to put these in the glass jars, and what's the process behind it?
So it's very easy. There's four basic components that I start with. It's always great to start these in advance a couple of days so that you have that usability just to pull it out of the refrigerator and toss it on your veggies or throw it in your stir fry or what have you to flavor stuff up. There are four basic components. One is oil. I use olive oil if I'm not going to stir fry something, if it's not going to high heat. You can use flaxseed oil or coconut oil. Oil is essential. That's what gives you those fats that help give you the satisfaction as well as help your digestion of these raw vegetables, especially if you're using them on salad. Your other component is citrus. Lots of different citrus out there. Don't just think lemon. Don't just think lime. One of your dressings tonight has grapefruit juice in it. So get creative. Literally put three jars out and be like, I'm going to put citrus in this one of lemon, lime in this one, grapefruit in this one. Squeeze your citrus in there. Citrus is fabulous because it actually balances out the iron in some of those leafy vegetables. So it also helps increase your immune system. So it's a good thing to always add with that oil. The other one is sea salt and vinegar. You guys have heard me say it before, the Himalayan sea salt. I'm a big fan of the minerals. It also enhances flavor. The vinegar, lots of different vinegars again. So get inventive, be creative. There's rice vinegar. There's apple cider vinegar. There's balsamic vinegar. Vinegars have great benefits to our digestion, to our metabolism. I think people have heard in the health world, take a teaspoon of apple cider vinegar a day. It doesn't taste that great, but what it tastes really good is when you mix some garlic and some oil and some spices in there. Then it tastes good. Same difference. Throw it on your salad. And then finally, the last thing that I always, the final component is herbs. Fresh, dried, doesn't matter. Be creative with it. So you have two different dressings. One's a traditional Italian vinaigrette. Tastes better than what you get in the store and much safer. Doesn't have the chemicals and additives. It's just that same oil, olive oil, the sea salt, the lemon juice, balsamic, and then spices. And I just threw a whole bunch of spices from my backyard. I put some rosemary, some thyme, basil, and garlic. And then I add my vegetables in with my dressing overnight. So I put my tomatoes, my red onions, and my avocado. The reason why is because they break down and they actually absorb the dressings, and then it just tastes better in your salad. Have you guys tried it yet?
No question about it. I mean, these dressings, they're not even close. I mean, people that are consuming the varieties from the grocery store are missing out big time on this. And, you know, as you go through this, all I can think is the simplicity of that is just too much. I mean, it is so easy for people to do. And you're right. You know, it's fun to make those concoctions. And again, one of the big things you've mentioned, we mentioned before, is it slows you down. You know, when it comes to this eating thing, we're oftentimes way too much in a rush. Making your own dressing slows you down. Again, again, to you you mentioned citrus too. You know, citrus is out there everywhere in this town, this county. It grows like weeds, and so many people don't use it. You know, I go out on these runs and I just see countless citrus trees that don't look like they've ever been touched, with hundreds, even thousands of fruits. So use these things and go forward. I know Paul has some concerns though here with the
I had a question because, you know, I'm the guy that dips my fork in my salad dressing. You know, that kind of, you can't do that with your salad dressings. There's not,
I was being free of dairy, but yes, you can do that with your salad dressing. It's called adding some nice whole milk yogurt. Well, that's all that is.
But you couldn't do that to these salad dressings, though, could you?
Yeah, you could. Both of them, actually, you could do very quite easily. Get some clotted cream, get some... you can make it. I mean, it's actually quite easy to make. People don't recognize how easy it is to make your own clotted cream or your own what they call sour cream here in the States. You can add any type of quote-unquote thickener to those if you need a dipping sauce.
That's for the ranch lovers. You know, you get all these people, you know, that sit to go to Firestone or go to, you know, these different places, and they got to dip everything in ranch. And I think that those are the ones that are going to be hardest to convert.
Let me tell you a secret of what ranch is. You ready? Because this is a girl from Texas. Ranch is sour cream with dry herbs and lemon juice. That's the big secret. So, it's a marketing push. These people created something that stabilizes on the shelf, and they've added stuff, and they put something in it that actually makes you crave it more. And that's what ranch dressing is. Ranch dressing comes from a specific name from people on a ranch who used to create dressing, and they used to use the clotted cream, which is also sour cream. That's all it is. It's not a complicated, they don't do something special other than add chemicals and MSG and things that are very bad for you, and then you pour it on your salad and you eat it thinking you're being healthy.
Spoiled milk.
Yeah, add some sour cream.
Spoiled milk and a handful of weed. And one of these lemons off a tree that Rick was talking about, and we got ranch dressing.
We got it. As always, Virginia, brilliant stuff. Please, we'll put these on for the listeners online, as we always do. Look forward to more stuff from you as we start to come into these holidays. I know people are going to dig where we're going with this, and always new ideas for the holidays to spice it up for the family and to impress a few people along the family lines. Bring in something new. Everybody's got to bring something.
Ranch for Paul next time.
Ranch for Paul for next time. Thank you, as always, Virginia. Talk to you next week.
Sounds good. Have a good one.
Hey, coming up next, I believe we're going to have Winter Vanecki on the phone. Coming up, no, Max. Justin. We're going to Justin Levine next. We're going Justin Levine coming up. 300 miles, folks, in 4 days. We had him on last time talking the route. He's actually completed this task. Stick with us. Justin Levine next on Living the Run.
With Living the Run.
Hey, welcome back to Living the Run. Good stuff there from Virginia. Again, we haven't hit it yet, but hit up the website, facebook.com. Hit up livingtherun.com. You find us on either one of those, and you can get these recipes. Brilliant stuff, and easy to do. Easy to just kind of have sitting around in the jars at home. And again, I think people don't realize how simple a lot of this stuff is, and that's why we go down those aisles, Paul, and we start picking up the dressings, or we start picking up stuff that we don't really realize that we only need 2, 3, 4 ingredients. You can make your own at home.
Well,
keep it fresh.
Yeah, I think the thing is, it really makes me feel bad when we talk to her, because she, you know, you think like, I'm not going to make dinner. I don't got the time. You know, I only have an hour, and I'm not gonna be able to do it. And then she's got, you know, a herd of children, and you know, she brings in like 5-course meals. She's, oh, it took me like 35 minutes. You just throw all this stuff together, and I'm like, wait, what?
Yeah, it's great. You know, she makes it simple. You know, when we look in the exercise world too. It's the same thing. Sometimes it's just so nice to be around a coach, to be around somebody who motivates you and drives you to do more. And you know, we had this guy on our next guest about a few weeks ago, I guess, in the middle of October.
I was here for that one, by the way.
You were here for that one.
I was here for that one.
Yay!
Yeah.
Gosh, I like it. That was your one for the month. Anyway, you know, it's good stuff because Justin was taking on a pretty tall task, running 300 miles in 4 days. But you know, he talked a lot about his team, you know, and the guys that were going to come with him, the guys that were going to motivate him. And so pretty neat. So we're excited now. We got on the line Justin Levine back with us. Justin, hey, congrats on incredible stuff. You know, talk to us about what went on out there. We're still kind of trying to fathom that whole thing, 300 miles in 4 days.
Yeah, I'm trying to fathom the whole thing too, man. It's mesmerizing. I started writing chapters of a book. I wrote my blog. I mean, it's mesmerizing to think back to this adventure, this journey, life changing. Human spirit was powerful out there. It's hard to even put it into words how magnificent it was out there. I mean, it took my physical body to the brink, I'm not going to lie, but it just developed like this deep mental, emotional, human spirit element that ultra running, deep endurance sports kind of tests, and it's unfamiliar, it's unknown. You can't expect when the time is going to come, and it just smacks you right in the face. So, you know, a couple things that I, you know, that really just hit my head was that determination is a stronger trait than weakness. Determination will lead you to moving in the right direction. You just have to be willing to use that determination. And the other component was just this optimistic energy, this bubble of energy that was kind of following us throughout the entire journey. was leading other people. My pace runners were breaking huge barriers. I mean, we had people come out there with us that were breaking their like max run by quadruple, five times the amount they've ever run in their life, and no injury. It was just, it was humbling, man. And I came back just with a better appreciation for life. You know, the people in my life are, you know, I just appreciate them at a higher level. And, you know, I wake up more positive and with, you know, the glass is definitely full. And so I'm excited, man, to continue to keep expressing this inspiration. The impact it made on our community and the people in our community was really outstanding and humbling, and I was very touched by the amount of text messages and Facebook messages that we were getting throughout the journey. And you know, it was just a really, really neat you know, 4.5 days that really the high of it all still continued and still implemented into our lives. So yeah, man, it was awesome.
Hey, Justin, talk about, you know, for those that missed your first interview with us, talk a little bit about the why. You know, why you guys decided to do this, what you know, got the goal going, what you were trying to achieve out there, and you know, the ultimate purpose behind why you chose to this task.
We all, as individuals, put limits in our life. We build up these walls that surround us, and it stops us from living and experiencing what life has to offer. And, you know, I started noticing this. I started seeing people that, you know, maybe it was in my fitness academy or friends or family that they just kept saying, I can't do that. And I was just like, that's like a limit. And if you learn to break that limit down, man, life becomes just magnificent. So I started developing this concept of putting myself through just, you know, quote-unquote unimaginable physical endurance event, and something that was going to be very challenging to me. But I wanted to prove to people that when you believe in yourself, when you surround yourself with positive, like-minded people, and when you start challenging yourself to break down those limits, anything is possible. And I truly believe that now, that anything is possible. So we developed this concept. It was a minor idea at first. It turned into a colossal of an event and an expedition. It turned into major impact. So it really, you know, accomplished the goal at hand. So it was a 300-mile run. You know, we played around with how many days we wanted to do it in and the exact course, but we dialed it into a 300-mile course where we ran up and down, basically starting in, you know, the Tulare County, and we went all the way into, you know, Santa Monica. And so we developed this concept. We had a committee. We met. We created brochures, posters. We even have little cool bracelets that says, I can do anything on the bracelet. And we've just been able to magnify this concept, this lifestyle, this mindset throughout not just 10, 20 people, but hundreds, thousands of people. And it's been, man, it's been humbling to see the impact. So, yeah, it was a 300-mile run. The goal was to do it in 100 hours. We ended up doing it in 101 and a half hours. We finished at noon on Saturday. The goal was to be done at 10:30 on Saturday. So, you know, we were pretty darn close to making this goal. We ran 68 miles day one, 58 miles day two, 70 miles day three. Waking up day four, we started at 7 a.m. We ended up running for 29 hours straight till Saturday that next day at noon. We ran 110 miles in that time frame because I had a goal. I was determined, and nothing was going to get in my way. Sleep deprivation, tiredness, sore feet, sore legs, nothing was going to get in my way. So we made it happen, man, and it was really cool to see our team come together and really get us to the goal.
Hey, how you doing, Justin? This is Paul. First off, congratulations. That's an incredible accomplishment. Now, here's a question for you, though. You just talked about it. You know, you said you missed your goal by about 100 or by about an hour and a half. Where did that happen? Was it kind of, you know, it sounds like you guys had a great plan. I mean, in order to make that plan and stick to it almost the whole way and come that close is great. Do you know where you may have lost that time, or if you decide to do something like that again, where you're going to make changes?
Yeah, after the first day, we ran, you know, we started off a little later than I wanted, because the first morning we had this big old community day and people came out and ran with us, so that just prolonged our start. So by the time 10:30 came around, we had ran 68 miles. We were on some busy highway. It was dark. It was dangerous. So we just decided to call it a night at that. And the first day we wanted to run, kind of on paper, we wanted to run close to 80 miles. So the first day is where I think we lost our mileage. Then it started turning into, okay, well, if we finish at noon, 1, 2, you know what? The goal is just to now finish. So quickly it became a flexible time goal instead of just trying to finish under this 100-hour limit. And, you know, sleep was important. I mean, a little bit of rest became important. But like I said, when we got to that last morning, when I'm talking about Friday morning, we still wanted to finish by noon that next day to keep us right around that significant goal. And when you start talking long distance, ultra distance type activity, being within 2 hours, 3 hours of a goal time, when you're talking over 200 mile event, I mean, I still think of it as a successful journey. But, you know, you start running 17-hour days, you get to the end of the night, and your body just doesn't want to go anymore. And so you decide as a team to make the decision to rest so you have some recovery for the next morning so you can get up and do it all over again, because that's the hardship of it all. That's the unaware territory that you're not used to, is waking up and running another 70 miles after you've done 2 days in a row that's similar. So we got to a point where it was just a matter of, now let's just get to the finish line. Whatever time frame we're looking at, let's just get to the finish line. And we were pretty, you know, we were very ecstatic to be really, really close to that goal time.
Hey, we're talking to Justin Levine here on ESPN 1280, The Ticket, here on Living the Run Radio. You know, Justin, I want you to get your pace man on there for a second. I know you got Joshua Hickey with you. Never heard of a pace man that ran 220 miles, but this is going to be the first. get him on the phone if you can.
Yeah, this is Josh right here.
Hey, Josh, you know, congratulations on being part of this team. Like I said, you know, Paul's been in track and field for a long time. I don't think he's ever heard of a pace guy at 220 miles, but...
I don't know if I've ever logged 220 miles cumulative over my entire career.
I want to hear from the perspective of a guy that's pacing and encouraging going along the way. Because we know we have a lot of people around here, too. You know, talk about a low moment. Where was one of the lowest moments? How did you sense it from Justin that it was a low moment? And what did the team do to rally around him to keep him going?
Well, we had all sorts of tricks in our bag. You know, they seem history loves company. So having somewhere on your side and suffering just as much as you are, it's pretty nice. Because you could look at each other. I remember we were running in the desert, and there was a hill coming out of Bakersfield, and Justin and I actually started challenging each other up that hill. And, you know, this was just after running through the desolate roads of Bakersfield, where the junkyard dogs were barking at us, and it was hot, and we were dehydrated. And so, you know, just to have that spirit of competition and looking at the person next to you, and they're suffering just as much as you do, so you get that camaraderie, and you start to really enjoy it because you've got company out there.
No, I'm just thinking of this out in the desert here, and it's like it's more of that camaraderie, but it may be just a little bit of deliriousness, you know, because you guys are miles and miles into this, and I'm assuming it was probably hot when you guys started running, correct?
Yeah, it was hot, but we also had, you know, we had the luxury of an RV. That RV would, it would park up the road, 4 miles, 6 miles, you know, whatever we, set as our next point to meet up with it. And when we got to the RV, you know, we had the amenities that we needed, whether that was ice or refilling or a grilled cheese sandwich. you know, whatever we were on schedule for, we would have that. So it wasn't like we were by ourselves out there. It was a well-planned, well-executed, and the support crew out there was awesome.
Hey, Josh, what's the one change you guys made that you didn't anticipate? I know you go into this thing, you try to plan the food, you try to plan the drink, you try to plan the sleep times, et cetera, like you said. What was the one thing that you guys didn't anticipate that you had to adapt to be able to continue on in the race?
We actually ran into Los Angeles, and right when we hit Los Angeles, within 10 miles, it was miserable running. I mean, we're 220 miles into a run, and now we're dodging traffic. We're losing our crew, our pace car, our food. I mean, it just got miserable, and here we are trying to zone out, trying to get to the end of this journey, and we can't do that. So we made a very strategic decision at that point where we packed up our camp and got in our RV. We drove into Camarillo. So that took us 60 miles north of our final destination, and we ran down Highway 1, the PCH, and that took us and got our mileage in that we needed. So that was honestly the best decision we could have made the entire trip, because once we got to Highway 1, it was 9 p.m. at night. There was barely any cars on the road. It was one straight shot into Santa Monica. The coast was in our background, listening to the waves, the stars were out. It was kind of a surreal moment there, because yes, we were delirious at this point. We ran deep into the night. We ran, at 3 a.m. I don't even think Josh finished the story, because at 3 a.m. was probably one of our lowest moments, because I started talking about sleeping in bushes and sleeping on trees, and I was hungry, I was tired, and at that point, we made a decision, too, to sleep for an hour. And so we all just kind of took off our shoes really quick. We got in the RVs. Josh got into his car. His wife had been following him. And we all just closed our eyes for 40 minutes and got back up. And you know, this was a pivotal point in the journey, because determination just was strong at that point. But yet, the weakness was in my head, too. And so I was definitely inside myself at that point, battling, do I stop, do I go, rest, but determination kept me leading forward. So at 4:30 in the morning, we kept moving, and we saw the sunrise, and we continued to make our progress to our destination. So there was a lot of low points, I'm not going to lie. There was a lot of times where, you know, I wasn't, quitting was never an option, but rest was always an option. So it was just, I needed to sit down, gather my thoughts, take my shoes and socks off, wash my feet, ice them up a little bit, and just keep moving forward. And when I felt right, my mind would just wake up and say, okay, get back up and keep going and moving forward. So there was a lot of battling throughout this event.
Hey, well, real quick, what's next for you guys? What's next on the agenda? How do people kind of follow along with you? If you have another event in the future, how do they get in touch with you? How do they find you online? Any of that?
Well, Josh Hickey and him and his crazy self is about to do Ironman Arizona in 2 weeks. And so he's, a 300-mile run, I guess, is a taper for him. And he's getting ready for a big event in a couple weeks. But you know what? For me right now, it's chill mode, it's hanging out with my family. In terms of training, it's doing anything that just sounds fun, but nothing super hard. Just kind of building my body back to get it back into training mode for next season.
Yeah, next year I'm going to bring Justin up to our park. We live by the Sequoia and Kings Canyon National Park, so we have some great backcountry ultra running up there, and the John Muir Trail is accessible, so we'll see if that gets on his agenda.
Hey, great. Hey, that sounds like a great idea. Keep us in the loop. We'll check in with you when you get whatever that race is. Josh, good luck at Arizona Ironman. Do well. Thanks, guys, so much. You're motivating a ton of people, and love your story.
Yeah, thank you, man, and we really appreciate you guys taking the time to talk to us. Thanks, Rex.
Hey, thanks a ton. Hey, good stuff, Justin Levine. Josh Hickey is pace runner. Wonderful, wonderful stuff. We will be back on the show in moments. Stick with us.
We're back with Living the Run.
Welcome back. Good stuff. Justin Levine is pace runner Joshua Hickey. I still can't get over there. A guy that paces somebody for 220 miles. That's
right before Iron Man. Man, I got to warm up for this Iron Man here. Let me get everything warmed up and stretched out. Yeah, 220 sounds good.
sounds just about right. It's about just what I need. A good 220-mile run. Incredible. So, is that what you did at the track? You said you made it to the track.
I made it to the track.
Paul,
it was. You know, it's hard for me to go to the track because it's as good as you used to be. You know what I mean? And I'm out there throwing this. shot put. I just did our multi throws, overhead back. Some jump hops and stuff. And it was very disappointing to see how far it wasn't going. Man, it was a lot of effort behind that one, but it didn't go very far. So, let's just say it was disappointing from that perspective. But it was just good to get out on the track, just get a warm up in, kind of feel normalcy again.
It's the one thing I noticed, you know, with working out over time, and we're going to talk to Ryan Joyner here from Athlon Elite in just a minute, and, you know, it's the same thing that I notice is that I don't lose a lot of strength. If anything, you kind of keep the strength pretty good. Endurance continues to get better, but that fast twitch stuff just goes away. It seems so hard to turn that on, you know, as you age. And I did hit the track a little bit today and got on there, and it just felt like it was harder to get that turnover. Not hard to keep a good long pace and go for a long time, but that turnover just disappears. That one thing that you know, you had years ago.
Well, it's funny. I don't even know if I should be telling you this, but you remember my old training partner Jamil?
Of course.
He'll be down here, I believe, in February or March, and we're gonna
Ivy League graduate.
Ivy League, Brown University.
Right. Yeah.
That's right. Went to law school. I told you that, right? Went to law school. He's getting ready to graduate from law school. And the reason he went to law school, couldn't find a $10 an hour job in San Luis. It was frustrating, and I was completely, I was shocked. I was like, nobody will give you a $10 an hour job.
Oh, well, it's a tough deal. I mean, Jamil, tremendous athlete.
It's a tough deal. You got a guy with a great personality, who's smart, Ivy League degree.
Yeah, smart, great athlete, and great energy.
Who wants that on their team?
That's the thing, and I think that we found it out last night in the politics, is there's just too many jobs. You know, this country's just overflowing with jobs, right? I mean, it's just, they're a dime a dozen, right? Everybody's making a ton of money. I know, it is bizarre. I mean,
what
I know
is the sun in your world?
I'm telling you, it's stunning
thing.
He's
coming down February, March-ish, 110 hurdle race over 39-inch hurdles. That's what we're going to have. Him and I are going to have a hurdle race. I'll probably be in your office the day after, 2 days after, 3 days after.
Great stuff. Hey, let's bring Ryan Joyner in. Ryan Joyner from Athlon Elite. Ryan, I wanted to ask you right off the bat, you know, when we start to talk about some of the fitness programs that you have, and we start to talk about some of these fast twitch type muscles and so forth, we just got off the phone with Justin Levine, Josh Hickey. These guys just went 300 miles, 220 and 300 miles, a much longer distance. Thing. One of the arguments out there in exercise these days is mixing things up, right? You always hear that term cross training, going through different cycles of training. How do we do it over there at Athlon Elite, where we have some times where we put people through more endurance stuff versus putting people through some of the fast twitch, short burst, anaerobic stuff?
How you doing? Good to talk to you again.
Hey, it's always good to have you.
You know what? We, for sure, you know what I mean? Variety of training is important, and that's certainly part of, you know, it's certainly a piece of the fact of what I'm trying to figure out how I want to answer this best, because, you know, again, that's such a complex question to answer quickly, but you need to train all of that. So fast twitch, you've got to train that. You also have to train the endurance muscle fibers. You have to train your agility. You have to train your coordination. You have to do all this stuff. And so putting all that into a single training program, you would basically have to work out 24/7, right? You have to work out 24 hours a day in order to accomplish everything. And so hence the concept of periodization, where you're going to particular focus on one particular skill in a phase of training, and then go to the next phase. And traditionally, a lot of people will do what's called a linear periodization, where they're going to get out there, work on endurance and stamina, then focus on strength for the next 4 weeks, then focus on power and speed for the next 4 weeks, and then repeat, you know, in real simple terms. At Athlon, we do what's called a conjugate method, and we do a little bit of everything at once with an emphasis. So we're we're doing power, speed, we're doing strength, we're doing agility, coordination, stamina, balance, all the above, all the time. But for a particular couple of weeks, we're focusing a little bit more on stamina. For another couple of weeks, we're putting a little more volume of training into the power part and a little less in the other areas. So that way we're always training every skill, because as you know, use it or lose it, it goes away. So as soon as you stop training power, even though you've been lifting weights, if you're not training speed, you're going to lose that skill, even though your strength is going up.
Now, do you give a an equal amount of time to, you know, each period there? Are you going to say, okay, a 6 week or an 8 week or a 4 week cycle or however you do it? Are you going to give each coordination or aerobic endurance, anaerobic endurance, and power? Are you going to give all those the same amount of time, or is one take a little bit more a little longer to develop than the others?
That's a good question, and usually that's in where that's where we get to the athlete specific. But in general terms, with the general industrial athlete, the average person that's coming in, we're going to do an equal amount of focus. We don't really notice that one takes. I mean, they all take long to develop, and again, each person has their natural gifts and what they're going to be good at. And if we're really looking for elite performance, then of course we're going to put the focus where it needs to be put for that person. So if they're behind on power development, then yeah, we're going to put a little bit more time into that side of things. And if they're behind in their stamina and that part of their game is lacking, then we're going to put more time into that. What we do find with almost everybody is that they're lacking strength. Even endurance athletes that come in and say, I need to do better, I'm running out of gas at the end of my race, we find that they're grossly lacking in strength. And the fact that the beginning parts of the race required so much more of their threshold effort, just because they didn't have the strength there, that then by the time they're done, they're completely gassed out by the end of the race. But if we can build a better base level of strength and put a little more time and focus into that, believe it or not, their endurance is much better, just simply because they weren't having to tap into that extra reserve of strength throughout the whole race, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and there's a happy medium, obviously, between weight training and actually putting on mass, and weight training and getting stronger. I mean, I think the big thing is you strengthen up the core, you strengthen up the legs, and you're going to improve stride length. And speed is just it's just a function of stride length and stride frequency. If so, for the same amount of effort, they're getting a little bit longer stride. They're gaining that much more every time they take a step.
Yeah, for sure.
Hey, real quick before we go, Ryan, what's going on over at Athlon now? I know we got coming into the holidays. Holidays is always a big time. People seem to want to start to make change and grab on to different programs coming in. The fear of the holiday extra weight and being dedicated this next year to wanting to work out come January. What's Athlon doing to address some of these issues? And really, I got to say, what are you doing to address the issues of getting people to make consistent decisions and not having to have a new New Year's resolution every year?
Yeah, well, we deal with that a lot, and we actually have a program called the Holiday Survival Program. And because the other thing that we face this time of the year is commitment. Nobody wants to commit to anything. Everybody's afraid that they're going to get crushed by holiday busyness, family, obligations, and all the above. And so nobody wants to commit to any kind of longer-term training plan. And so we have a short, four-week, kick-in-the-pants holiday survival program that's a little bit of everything. It's, it's either the personalized training, or it is in our higher intensity group program that you're doing more often. And then, of course, everything we're looking at nutrition. We're trying to make sure that they're cutting out the junk carbs and all the stuff that you guys have already been talking about today, making good choices when they're shopping. And then, and if they're partaking a little bit of holiday excess, at least when we're seeing them once, twice, or three times a week, we're able to give them a little guidance and motivation to at least stick to a healthy, natural, whole foods eating plan.
Hey, good stuff as always, Ryan. I like that. The Holiday Survival Program, we'll be promoting that these next few weeks. For those that want to check that survival program out or just want to check out Athlon Elite, you can go either call 805-546-6070 or go to Athlon. triathlonelite.com. As always, check in with Ryan Joyner, and you will not be led wrong. So thanks again, Ryan. We'll check in with you next week. Good holiday stuff, and thanks for the tips.
Yeah, thank you. We'll talk to you soon.
All right. That's good stuff, Paul. You know, it sounded like he might even be able to take your former self and convert some of that fast twitch stuff back and get you thrown well again.
It's never coming back. It's never. You know, I actually thought for like a holiday program, what would be great is if somebody had something where they charge you like an exorbitant amount of money, like $2,000 for like a month, and then you actually got most of that refunded if you actually showed up for it. You know what I mean? Give people that incentive. Don't just give them the incentive of that carrot on the end of the stick. Be like, no, seriously, we'll give you your money back or some of it if you show up. That'd be pretty sweet.
You know, it's funny you say that because I've always thought that was the best healthcare program. You know, you set up healthcare programs designed to get people to get money back from their insurance companies if they got off the blood pressure medication because they lost weight.
I stopped taking it. Your blood pressure's still high. Yeah. I want my refund.
Yeah, they got off the type 2 diabetic medication. You know, they stopped smoking. They stopped drinking. Whatever it might be, but they had health-oriented goals that allowed them to, you see, objective change and do things with goal-oriented stuff. It's a brilliant idea.
One of my coaches in college talked about that, and he said it would be great if they just had like a very simple fitness test, you know, completely objective, you know what I mean? Nothing, no judgments or anything in it, but very simple, like pull-ups and push-ups and body weight squat kind of thing. And you come in, you do that, boom, you get like a discount or you get a refund or whatever at the end of the year. You keep yourself in shape, give you some money back.
You know, one of the things I thought was funny in that movie, Fat, Sick, and Nearly Dead, if you haven't seen this documentary, you gotta watch this one. But the doctor, here's this guy, he's like 450 pounds walking in, and he says, I'd like to start juicing. You know, I'd like to start, you know, getting the vegetables and fruits and start juicing every day. Would that be okay? And she kind of looked at him like, I guess I'd be okay. Seems like a decent idea. It's amazing. You're this guy, 450 pounds. He's asking if he can eat more fruits and vegetables, and she's kind of hesitating, like, yeah, I guess. I mean,
why not? You know what? Why not?
And then he comes in the next time after like 2 weeks, he's lost like 40 pounds, and she's like, well, that seems to be working. You know, maybe. Okay, he goes, can I keep going? Yeah. I mean, yeah, seems like a good idea.
What kind of doctor was this? Not a good one.
Incredible stuff. Hey, we're sorry we lost Winter Vanecki this show. We thought we were going to have her. We hope to get Winter Vanecki back next week. Always, always inspiring stuff from her. Great show tonight, Paul. You know, definitely walking away inspired by Justin Levine and his buddy Josh Hickey. Some good stuff, motivating stuff. And as always, that's what we try to hope to bring here on Living the Run. So as we say, we look forward to seeing you next week. Live healthy this week. Live bold. Come live the run.